Hello everyone, my name is Yu Liu. I'm from the YKLP of Yunnan University. Today I'm going to talk about animal features and body plan. Animals bewilder us with their diversity of form and function. Despite their great diversity, animals have much in common. For example, locomotion is a distinctive characteristic. We're going to explore the great diversity of modern animals, which is the result of a long evolutionary history. I shall begin with a discussion of the features that characterize animals and review the phyla at the base of the animal phylogeny. In the next two lectures, I shall introduce the two major groups of animals, the protostomes and deuterostomes. Animals are so diverse that few criteria fit them all, but some, such as animals being eaters or consumers, apply to all. Others, such as animals being mobile, have exceptions. Taken together, the universal characteristics and other features of major importance exhibited by most species are convincing evidence that animals are monophyletic, that they descended from a common ancestor. The features described in the proceeding section evolved over the course of millions of years. We can understand how the history of life has proceeded by examining the types of animal bodies and body plans present in fossils and in existence today. Five key innovations can be noted in animal evolution: symmetry, tissues, allowing specialized structures and functions, a body cavity, various patterns of embryonic development and segmentation, or repeated body units. Some innovations appear to have evolved only once, some twice or more. Innovations that have only evolved a single time can provide evidence of close evolutionary relationship, thus serving as a synapomorphy, shared derived character, for an evolutionary group composed of an ancestral species and all of its descendants, termed a clade. On the other hand, some innovations evolve more than once in different clades. This is the phenomenon of convergent evolution. Although not indicative of close evolutionary relationship, convergently evolved innovations may be evidence that distantly related species have adapted in similar ways to similar environmental conditions. All animals are heterotrophs, that is, they obtain energy and organic molecules by ingesting other organisms. Unlike autotrophic plants and algae, animals cannot construct organic molecules from inorganic chemicals. Some animals, herbivores, consume autotrophs. Other animals, carnivores, consume heterotrophs. Some animals, omnivores, consume both autotrophs and heterotrophs, and still others, detritivores, consume decomposing organisms. Autotrophic nutrition is a type of nutrition in which organisms synthesize the organic materials they require from inorganic sources. Chief sources of carbon and nitrogen are carbon dioxide and nitrates, respectively. All green plants are autotrophic and use light as a source of energy for a synthesis. That means they are photoautotrophic. Some bacteria are also photoautotrophic, others are chemoautotrophic, using energy derived from chemical processes. Heterotrophic nutrition is a type of nutrition in which energy is derived from the intake and digestion of organic substances, normally plant or animal tissues. The breakdown products of digestion are used to synthesize the organic materials required by the organism. All animals obtain their food this way. They are heterotrophs. All animals are multicellular. Many have complex bodies. Unicellular heterotrophic organisms which were at one time regarded as simple animals, are now considered members of several different clades within the large and diverse group of protists. Animal cells differ from those of other multicellular organisms. They lack rigid cell walls and are usually quite flexible. The many cells of animal bodies are held together by extracellular frames of structural proteins such as collagen. Other proteins form unique intercellular junctions between animal cells. Although other single-celled organisms are able to travel from place to place, animals move more rapidly and in more complex ways. This ability is perhaps their most striking characteristic, one directly related to the flexibility of their cells and the evolution of nerve and muscle tissues. A remarkable form of movement unique to animals is flying, a capability that is well developed among vertebrates and insects. Many animals are sessile or sedentary. Animals vary greatly in form, ranging in size from organisms too small to see with the unaided eye to enormous whales and giant squids. Almost all animals lack a spinal cord. They are therefore called invertebrates, like the fossil euarthropod in figure 5. Probably most of the many millions of animal species awaiting discovery are invertebrates. Animals are grouped into 35 to 40 phyla, most of which have members that occur only in the sea. Members of fewer phyla occur in fresh water, and members of fewer still occur on land. Members of three phyla that are successful in the marine environment, arthropoda, mollusca, and chordata, also dominate animal life on land. Only one animal phylum, Onychophora, is entirely terrestrial. The Onychophora, with circa 160 species between 5 mm and 15 cm long form, the sister group to the more than 1 million arthropod species with articulated appendages. The body of the Onychophora contains a maximum of 43 pairs of uniramous legs, which end in a pair of claws. It is from this clause that the Onychophora derive its name. Most animals reproduce sexually. Animal eggs, which are non-mobile, are much larger than the small, usually flagellated sperm. In animals, cells formed in meiosis function as gametes. These haploid cells do not divide by mitosis first, as they do in plants and fungi, but rather fuse directly with each other to form the zygote. Consequently, there is no counterpart among animals to the alternation of haploid and diploid generations characteristic of plants. Some individuals of some species and all individuals of a very few others are incapable of sexual reproduction. An animal zygote first undergoes a series of mitotic divisions called cleavage. Cleavage produces a ball of cells, the blastula. In most animals, the blastula folds inward at one point to form a hollow sac with an opening at one end called the blastopore. An embryo at this stage is called a gastrula. The subsequent growth and movement of the cells of the gastrula differ from one group of animals to another, reflecting the evolutionary history of the group. Embryos of most kinds of animals develop into a larva, which looks unlike the adult of the species, lives in a different habitat, and eats different sorts of food. In most groups, it is very small. A larva undergoes metamorphosis, a radical reorganization to transform into the adult body form. The cells of all animals, except sponges, are organized into structural and functional units called tissues. Collections of cells that together are specialized to perform specific tasks. A typical sponge lacks definite symmetry, growing as an irregular mass. Virtually all other animals have a definite shape and symmetry that can be defined along an imaginary axis drawn through the animal's body. The two main types of symmetry are radical and bilateral. The body of a member of phylum Cnidaria exhibits radial symmetry. Its parts are arranged in such a way that any longitudinal plane passing through the central axis divides the organism into halves that are approximately mirror images. The bodies of most animals other than sponges and cnidarians exhibit bilateral symmetry, in which the body has right and left halves that are mirror images of each other. Animals with this body plan are collectively termed the bilateria. The sagittal plane defines these halves. A bilaterally symmetrical body has, in addition to left and right halves, dorsal and ventral portions, which are divided by the frontal plane, and anterior and posterior ends, which are divided by the transverse plane. In echinoderms, adults are radially symmetrical, but the larvae are bilaterally symmetrical. In this case, examination of animal phylogeny indicates that the radial symmetry of the adult is an evolutionarily derived condition from a bilaterally symmetrical ancestral condition. We consider echinoderms to be bilaterally symmetrical. Bilateral symmetry constitutes a major evolutionary advance in the animal body plan, associated with directional movement in the grouping of nerve cells into a brain and sensory structures, such as eyes and ears, at the anterior end of the body. This concentration of nervous tissue at the anterior end, which appears to have occurred early in evolution, is called cephalization. Cephalization is often considered a consequence of the development of bilateral symmetry. The zygote has the capability of giving rise to all the kinds of cells in an animal's body. That is, it is totipotent. In all animals except sponges, the process whereby cells specialize in performing specific functions during embryogenesis is irreversible. Once a cell differentiates to serve a function, it and its descendants can never serve any other. A sponge cell that had specialized to serve one function can lose the special attributes that serve that function and change to serve another function. Thus, a sponge cell can de-differentiate and re-differentiate, but their competence to de-differentiate prevents sponge cells from forming clearly defined tissues. The evolution of specialized tissues may be a key innovation, a trait that fosters evolutionary diversification. During embryogenesis, the cells of most animals organize into three layers: an ectoderm, an endoderm, and a mesoderm. Animals with three embryonic cell layers are said to be triploblastic. The ectoderm gives rise to the outer covering of the body and the nervous system. The endoderm gives rise to the digestive system, including the intestine, and the skeleton and muscles develop from the mesoderm. Cnidarians are diploblastic and lack organs. Sponges lack germ layers altogether. They, of course, have no tissues or organs. All triploblastic animals are members of the bilateria. A key innovation in the body plan of some bilaterians was a body cavity isolated from the exterior of the animal. This is different from the digestive cavity, which is open to the exterior at least through the mouth, and in some animals at the opposite end as well, via the anus. The evolution of efficient organ systems within the animal body was not possible until a body cavity evolved for accommodating and supporting organs. The cavity is filled with fluid. In most animals, the fluid is liquid, but in vertebrates, it is gas. In some animals, a body cavity called the pseudocoelom develops embryologically between the mesoderm and endoderm, and thus occurs in the adult between tissues derived from the mesoderm and those derived from endoderm. Animals with this type of body cavity are termed pseudocoelomates. Although the word pseudocoelom means false coelom, this is a true body space and characterizes many groups of animals. A coelom is a cavity that develops entirely within the mesoderm. The coelom is surrounded by a layer of epithelial cells derived from the mesoderm. The coelom arises within the mesoderm. In protostomes, cells simply move apart from one another to create an expanding coelomic cavity within the mass of mesodermal cells. In deuterostomes, groups of cells pouch off the end of the archenterium, the primitive gut, the hollow in the center of the developing embryo that is lined with endoderm. The consistency of deuterostome development and its distinctiveness from that of the protostomes suggest that it evolved once in the ancestor of the deuterostome phyla. The mode of development in protostomes is more diverse, but because of the distinctiveness of spiral development, scientists infer it also evolved once in the common ancestor to all spiralian phyla. As we shall see, our modern understanding of animal phylogeny supports these conclusions. All animals are multicellular and heterotrophic, and their cells lack cell walls. Most animals can move from one place to another, can reproduce sexually, and possess unique tissues. Animals are distinguished based on symmetry, tissues, type of body cavity, sequence of embryonic development and segmentation. Bilateral animals are those that have bodies bilaterally symmetrical. Within bilaterians, protostomes develop the mouth prior to the anus. Deuterostomes develop the mouth after the anus has formed. Segmentation is conducive to efficient locomotion. A pseudocoelom is a space that develops between the mesoderm and endoderm. A coelom develops entirely within mesoderm. That's all for now. See you next time.